Hey, what's up everyone? So for this week, I want to do a follow-up to last week's video. And the reason why I want to do this follow-up is because some of you made a very good remark in the comments. You said in the comments that while the tip I showed you to make code that relies on a shared instance testable was indeed an interesting trick, it probably wouldn't scale very well. Meaning that in my code, it worked pretty well, but I was only dealing with a single method from the user default. So this method right here. And if I had to deal with several methods, the tip wouldn't scale well because I would have to add a new argument to the function for each new method. And of course, as you can imagine, if we start getting at the point where we have 5, 6, 7, or 8 extra arguments in a method, it's definitely not the kind of code that we want to have. So I figured that for this week, it would be a nice topic to see how we could rework the tip a little bit in order to make it more scalable and maybe at the price of having to write a little bit more boilerplate code. So first, let's start by reminding ourselves with what we achieved last week. So the issue I wanted to solve was that I wanted to be able to make this code testable, so code that relied on the user defaults to persist data. And the way I achieved this was by introducing an injection point. So a place where I could be able to inject a different code than the one that relied on the shared instance. I decided to put this injection point in the argument list. And the reason why I made that choice is because it both gave me the ability to inject a different function while also letting me leverage the default value so that when I don't want to provide a different version of the saving function, I can just use the default one and basically I wouldn't have to modify any of my call sites. So I definitely want to keep this principle of introducing a new argument and using it as an injection point because I think it makes a lot of sense and it has some good ergonomics thanks to the default value. But what I want to do is I no longer want to directly inject the method that will be called. Instead, I'm just going to inject the instance on which I'm going to call the method. So I'm going to update the code and we're going to see how it looks like. Okay, let's take a look at what has changed. As you can see, I am no longer injecting through the argument the method to save the username. Instead, I am injecting an instance of user defaults. I am still using the default value in order to provide as a default value the shared instance. And then inside the body of my method, I'm just going to call the method setValueForKey on this instance of user defaults. What's really nice is that this is the only modification that I have to do on my code. And now that I have made this modification, my code is going to scale much better because I am absolutely able to call other methods on my user default. I am not restricted to only one method and I can totally call another method and it will not require me to change anything in the argument list. So I'm going to remove this extra code. But what's important is that we can see that we have achieved our goal of making this tip more scalable because we are still able to inject a mocked instance. We're going to see how we create one, but as you can see, through this injection point, I am able to inject something else as long as it is of type user defaults, and I still have access to the shared instance as a default value. So inside my method, my code is still pretty simple and there is no, we could say, penalty or boilerplate code associated with making the code testable. Of course, the next step now is going to be to update my testing code because while I am done with updating my production code, if I go back to my testing code, as you can imagine, this code is no longer going to build because I need to update it since the saving function argument no longer exists. So now the question is, how am I going to do in my testing code to provide a mocked implementation of my user defaults instance? And the trick here is to remember that user defaults is a class. And since it is a class, we are able to subclass it. So I'm going to start implementing a subclass of user defaults in my testing code. And now that I have started to implement a subclass of user default, what I'm going to do is that I'm going to override the method that is called controlled by my production code. So in this case, that method is the following one, set value for key. And what I'm going to do is that in this new implementation, I'm not going to call super, and instead I'm just going to implement the code that was implemented here in the closure that I was passing to my method save username. So I'm going to take the two pieces of state, so the persisted username and the persistence key. Instead, I'm going to store them here in my mock user defaults. Then in my overridden implementation of set value for key, I'm going to store the values of both arguments inside these two properties. And after that, all that I have left to do is to create an instance of my mock user defaults in my testing code. So like this. Then at the call side of my method save username, I'm going to remove this piece of code. And instead, I'm going to inject my mocked instance of user defaults. And finally, the last thing I have to do is simply update my two assertions. And that's it. My test code has been updated. So now I'm going to build and run my test just to make sure that everything is still working fine. And as you can see, it's indeed the case. The test is successful. So now, how about we recap what we have learned in this video? So let me go back to my production code. And let's start with the problem we wanted to solve. So we wanted to make code that relied on a shared instance testable. Here, my method save username relies on userDefaults.standard. And we wanted to make this code testable while keeping, we could say, the refactoring effort to a minimum. And the way we achieved it is that we introduced a new argument to the method save username. And this new argument is an instance of user default and comes with a default value, which is the shared instance. And what's really nice is that while my method retains the ability to interact with user default, the only difference is that instead of directly referencing the shared instance, I am now referencing the argument inside the method. I also have the possibility at my call site to inject a different instance of user default than the shared instance. And if I go back to my test, as you can see, this is exactly what I am doing in order to inject a mocked instance of user default. And how do I implement this mocked instance of user default? I do it by leveraging subclassing, meaning that inside my testing code, I implement a mock user default that is a subclass of user default. And inside this subclass, I override the method that I want to mock. And inside this overridden method, I just implement my mocking code. And then all that I have left to do is to create an instance of my mock in my test, pass it as an argument to my method save username, and finally use the properties inside the mock to write my assertions. And that's all for this video about another tip to make code that relies on a shared instance testable while keeping the refactoring effort to a minimum. As always, if you have any kind of feedback on what I've shown you, please let me know in the comments. Thanks a lot for watching the video and see you next time.